A process is actually a program in execution. In other words, on your disk you have some files that are just data files, for example a doc or docx file, or some programs like Word executable file, Excel, PowerPoint, the programs you write, Eclipse, whatever. So look at the executable files. These are programs. For example, it's a C or Java, Python, whatever program you have written. But when it's residing on your disk, it's a program. When you run that program, a process is created out of that program that is running. That one is called a process. So a process is actually an instance, a running instance of your program. What's of importance for us in operating systems is the running program, which is the process. That's why we always talk about processes, or sometimes call it task or job. But let's say process in more general terms. So a process is a unit of work within the system. It's passive. The program itself is passive because it's not doing anything. It's just residing on the disk. And when it becomes active, it's called a process. The process typically needs some resources to accomplish those tasks, like CPU, memory, input-output privileges, access to files, whatever, and also initialize the data to start execution. And when the process ends, all of these resources that were given to that process should be reclaimed by the operating system. If this is not done properly soon, for example, all of your programs will have completed, but when you want to run a new program, you will receive a message like out of memory. Actually, there's no one using the memory, but some memory has been reserved to some processes earlier, but they were not reclaimed properly. That's, for example, what we call a memory leak, because there's a leak in the operating system that the memory, available memory, reduces in time to some point where almost no process can run at all. If you're talking about a single-threaded process, we'll talk about multi-threading later. If you have a single process, single-threaded process, you have a single program counter. The program counter is a special-purpose register in the CPU, which keeps the address of the next instruction to be executed. And the process executes the instructions in this thread one after another in a sequential manner until the last instruction, which is also terminating the whole process. And multi-threaded processes have one program counter per thread, because in that case, each thread could be at different points, so the next instruction for each thread would be different. Therefore, you need one program counter per process. Note that you have if you have a single core, single CPU, there is only one program counter register, but it has to be assigned the value from the program counter of each thread, depending on which thread is being executed at that very moment. Typical systems have many processes, some number of users, and some running, some operating system running concurrently, some operating system processes, user processes, all running concurrently on a single CPU or multiple CPUs. And concurrency should be provided by multiplexing the CPUs among these processes or threads of these processes. The operating system should provide means for creating and deleting both the user processes and the system processes. It should be able to suspend processes, for example, when it is running short of memory, or specifically you want a process to be suspended, and later also be able to resume these processes from where they were left. provide some mechanism for synchronization between the processes. We'll spend a couple of chapters on this. That's an important concept. And process communication, which is closely related. And when you're doing synchronization, it is possible that you hit deadlocks, and you should have some means of handling these deadlocks. These are separate chapters on their own. You should be able to manage the memory properly. To execute a process, either the whole memory it needs should be provided, or at least some part of it. That's again something we are going to discuss when we start discussing virtual memory. So memory management deals with this. It tries to optimize CPU utilization and responsiveness of the computer for the user requests. Memory management provides activities like keeping track of which part of the memory is reserved for which process and to whom that process belongs. Deciding which processes or parts of the processes and data should be brought into memory or out of the memory. Allocation and deallocation, in other words, reclaiming of memory space. For the case of storage management, the operating system should provide a uniform view of information on the storage device. From the hardware point of view, depending on what type of a device is, it's just a system to store many bits. For example, if it's a disk, it will have to say this platter, this surface of the platter, this sector of, or this cylinder, whatever. But what we need as the users, we look at our information in terms of files. So the operating system's storage management has to provide means for identifying where a file is stored on the storage device. So it has to do all that translation. For each medium, like disk drive, tape drive, whatever, there are different access speeds, capacities, data transfer rates, how you access that data, whether it is sequential or random, whatever. This should all be handled by the storage management. For the file system management, yes, we want to store our information in files, but we have so many files that we'd like to organize them in directories. The access control on most systems determine who can access which data or which file. The operating system activities include means of creating and deleting files and directories. Primitives, that means functions, to manipulate these files and directories, like changing their permissions, moving them around, making copies of them, whatever. Provides mapping from files onto secondary storage, like this file is stored on this cylinder on the disk. Backup of files onto some stable, typically non-volatile storage media. All these are to be provided by the storage management. For the case of mass storage management, usually the disks contain a lot of data that do not fit in memory and also that should be preserved even after the computer has been shut down for long periods of time. But typically, even the disk may not be sufficient for you. So you need a proper management of the data. The speed of the computer's operation significantly depends on the storage management performance. So the operating system should provide free space management. How much disk space do I have left? Allocate space and do disk scheduling when multiple processes try to access the disk. Some storage should be very fast. Some may not need to be so fast. For example, a bank still needs to store bank accounts that have not been used even for years, but still you have to keep it there. Okay, so sometimes we need not secondary but tertiary storage devices. This is data that needs to be stored it should be kept, but you will not need it very often, and when you need it, it's not needed immediately. It's not like, get me all the data for this bank account at this very moment. If it's rarely needed, we can tolerate for some delay. In that case, we can store it in some optical devices or even on magnetic tapes. But still, the operating system should provide means for managing all these. There are different approaches, like WORM, which is write once, read many times. In this case, writing performance is not very important because you write only once. So a slow write operation is acceptable. The important thing is read should be fast. Or read write, like the number of reads and writes are approximately equal. So in that case, the performance of write operations, that would also be significant. We discussed earlier levels of storage, like at the very top we had the registers, at the very bottom we had the magnetic tapes, and we have optical storage, whatever. So not going all the way down, let's look at the top five of them. We had, remember, registers, cache, main memory, solid state disk, then the magnetic disk. These are the ones you would typically have in most computer systems. Here we have them in terms of their typical sizes. Of course, you can find them in different sizes. The type of technology used to implement them, the time to access the data on these devices, bandwidth is how much data can be transferred at most in one, for example, second, in one time unit. Who manages it typically, and who backs it. So if you go from left column to the right column, you will see that the size is increasing. So typically, as we said, the size of the registers is very small. So is cache, but slightly larger than registers. And it goes larger as you go towards magnetic disks. But when you go right, the size increases, but also the access time gets worse. So these access times here are given in nanoseconds. So for the case of registers, it's between 0.25 and 0.50 nanoseconds, whereas in the case of a magnetic disk, it is 5 million nanoseconds. See the difference in access time and also the size. Since the access time is so slow, of course, the bandwidth is also significantly affected. If the access time is short, of course, you can transmit data at very high bandwidths. But as the access time gets longer, your bandwidth will typically reduce. That means it will become slower. And don't forget that the first three columns are typically volatile, whereas the last two are non-volatile. We already discussed this, but the disk is typically too slow for the CPU to work with. So this information has to be carried, either the program code or the data itself has to be carried from the disk to the main memory for the CPU to work with. But if the CPU needs this bit of information frequently, it's a better idea to put it in the cache, because cache is much faster than main memory, as we have seen in the previous slide. And at the very moment that it's going to be used in the current instruction, from the cache you carry into the registers, the CPU itself works with the register itself. And when it is done, it will be placed back towards the left. Now, when we're talking about caching, remember that the cache corresponds to part of the main memory. So what you're searching for could be in cache or not. If it's not in cache, you get it from the main memory. While giving it to the CPU, you also make a copy in the cache. And when you're doing an update, you update it in the cache. But do you immediately replace it update it also in the main memory or do it later? That's an important concern in terms of performance. In most systems, for example, this update is delayed because probably it will be updated soon once again. Or maybe I can delay this update operation a little bit so that I can provide more information to the CPU faster, to the registers. But when the cache becomes idle, when it has time, it can do the updates, whatever. But this will cause a problem we call cache coherency, because what's the content in the main memory and the content in the cache could be different. So the operating system should have means for dealing with this. These are things to be discussed later in the course. The I/O subsystem is as follows. The operating system tries to hide the peculiarities of the hardware devices from the users. Each device has different properties. We don't want the user to deal with these details. So the I/O subsystem is responsible for managing the memory, like you have the buffers, dealing with the buffers, caches, and the spooling. Spooling is interconnecting the output of one job to the input of another. So the I/O subsystem is responsible for dealing with these, providing a general device driver interface, although the individual devices could have some peculiarities, and drivers for specific hardware devices also, things that are not so generic, those also should be provided by the I/O subsystem. Protection and security is of course a very important concept in operating systems. Protection is any mechanism for controlling the access of the processes or the users to the resources in that operating system. Security is a more general concept, so it's the defense of the system against both internal and external attacks. So you can have users in your system trying to hack other users in the same system, or you can have people from outside, not in your system, trying to hack your system. Security covers a very wide range, including denial of service attacks, worms, viruses, identity theft, theft of services, whatever. Systems typically, the operating systems typically provide what we call user IDs, the identities that correspond to specific users, one for each user. And the user ID is then associated with the files and directories and the processes that user specifically is running, for example, if you talk about processes or the files of that user. So you might want to access any other user in the system to access my files, or I might want to share it with some specific users but not the others. So therefore we can also, for example, create group IDs, and we normally do. For example, I can have instructors group, students group, staff group. Some files and services would be shared between the instructors, but not with the staff or the students, and vice versa. And we can also have privilege escalation, which is temporarily letting a user get a different privilege. For those of you who are a little bit familiar with Linux operating system, for example, this is what happens when you do sudo. Normally, you don't have the permission to read or write that specific file, but temporarily, you're given a restricted capabilities. The capabilities are restricted, but within that restriction, you're able to access, read or modify some file. For example, when you're trying to change the password, you need to be able to modify the etc password and etc shadow files. This is something, as a regular user, you're not allowed to do. But when you use the password program, temporarily it will switch to a higher privilege level, do the operation. but only your password, not other people's password, and then exit. So this is the end of this chapter, and these are the reading assignments. As I said in chapter zero, I expect you to have read all of these reading assignments, and you will be responsible for them in the discussions and also in the exams.